I have the pleasure and privilege today of introducing our final keynote speaker for our convening. And it's especially thrilling for me. This person's seminal work, Black Feminist Thought, has been really important to me and my personal scholarship. So my own inner emerging researchers doing Dr. Malinga high kicks right now, because this is a person whose scholarship has helped me find my place in the academy, has helped me theorize Black womanhood, and she's really one of the most foremost sociologists living in the world today. So it is such a treat for us to have her. It is really a full circle moment for me personally to go from having cited someone's work in undergrad and master's to now be introducing them today for our convening. And I'm talking about Patricia Hill Collins. Professor Patricia Hill Collins is a distinguished university professor emerita at the University of Maryland in College Park and a distinguished professor of sociology and Africana studies at the University of Cincinnati. She's the author of 10 books, among them her award-winning Black Feminist Thought and Black Sexual Politics, and numerous articles and essays. Professor Hill Collins has taught at several institutions. She's held editorial positions with professional journals, has lectured widely in the US and internationally, has served on a number of professional boards and community organizations. And in 2008, she became the 100th president of the American Sociological Association, the first time an African-American woman was elected to that position. And her recent books include Intersectionality as Critical Theory and The Lethal Intersections, Race, Gender, and Violence, which has come out this year. I like to think of Patricia Hill Collins as the godmother of intersectionality. And that's not to discount Kimberly Crenshaw's contributions, but I think what Patricia has done is she's really theorized the term to such an extent that it's become now this transferable knowledge product that's found usefulness outside of the US context in which it was created. And it helps us understand how a combination of social identities, race, class, geography, gender, poverty, disability, religion, and sexuality, how all these things can converge, how they intersect to form interlocking systems of oppression that affect the way people see the world around them, their individual and their group life chances. Intersectionality helps us recognize how power imbalances and hierarchies at work in Africa, for example, operate at different levels and take multiple forms from all the categories I mentioned before to things like asset ownership, to resource rights, to political decision making, ethnicity, and I think an underexplored area is age. There's not much written about age in this intersectionality scholarship, and Patricia will speak to this, but it's an important category for us as African scholars to think about as well, especially when you think about Alcinda's or Onwana's concept of waithood, which speaks to the delay or the curtailment of adulthood as youth remain trapped in a state of waithood between childhood and adulthood due to structural conditions. And for Africans, especially young Africans, transitions to adulthood have become so uncertain, so precarious, and a growing number of young men and women must improvise livelihoods and conduct their personal relations outside of dominant economic and familial networks. But young people are not powerless. They do and they can act agentially, and we certainly see that in our country, which has a rich history of youth-led mobilization, recent protest movements, which we know stem directly from feeling suffocated by these intractable challenges, these wicked problems that threaten the very air that we breathe. So while Professor Patricia Hill Collins will be talking about the US context today, more than ever, we're seeing shared experiences among young people in the majority world and in the global north as these intractable problems confront us all every day. Dr. Cassius Lubisi touched on the broad scope of these challenges quite nicely on day one. Poverty, unemployment, rising authoritarianism, violence and conflict, climate change, which we know affects women disproportionately, migration, pandemics, and the austerity and precarity that emerge from these shocks and also impact young people disproportionately. Finally, Chido also drew our attention to the image of that young girl in a village. And she has potentially her gender, she has potentially her age, she has potentially her rurality working against her. And her condition is exacerbated if, for instance, she's an ethnic minority, she's a religious minority, or she's living with a disability, for instance. When we take it back home and think about the work that we do here, whether it's research on reproductive rights, whether it's xenophobia, whether you're doing research on populations most likely to have pre-existing health conditions, access to education, and so on, we would all be served, I think, to embrace intersectionality as a useful tool for analysis, for advocacy, for policy development that addresses multiple discriminations and helps us understand how different sets of identities impact on access to rights, opportunities, communities, and institutions. So without further ado, let's turn our attention to Patricia Hill Collins, who is going to talk to us today about the intersectional and intergenerational youth-led activism to address the challenges of our time. She has recorded her virtual address, but she will be joining us live for a Q&A directly after.
Very nice to be at the conference and talk with you this morning. I do have a regret that I have not been able to be with you, but what I've brought today is the talk that I wanted to give, and I brought today work that I am working on now. It is on Black youth, intersectionality, and political activism. Now, those three terms have meaning to me: Black youth, intersectionality, and political activism. So that is the focus of my talk today. Everybody faces this one question, all of us when we are young: what is my place and purpose in the world? Where do I fit? Where do I fit in the society or the culture where I live? But not all of us can answer that question in the same way, because we are in very different situations. The world has changed around me. I used to ask that question to my students when I was teaching undergraduates: what is your place and purpose in the world? How will you find that out? But now, when I talk with students, the question is much more: can I see a future for myself in the world that I have inherited? There's a shift, I would argue, in the worldview of youth generally, but Black youth in particular, around: is there a future for me? Is there a place for me? Do I want to fit into the world that I have inherited? Will it even be there? So these broader existential questions, I think, foster a worldview among youth, all youth, but today I will be talking about Black youth. So the first part of the talk: intractable problems, intractable youth, Black youth in the United States. Now, I went on the web and I looked up intractability, because it's a word I don't use that often, but it was really interesting, the nuance that I found. Intractable problems: those are social problems that are very difficult to control, manage, or solve. They're problems that are thorny and knotty, and you can't do much about them. But intractable problems were also described as defiant, opposing, disobedient, and resistant. The word intractable also invoked those particular characteristics. So I thought, this is really very interesting, because when it comes to Black youth in the United States, in many ways, Black youth are perceived as being intractable, defiant, opposing, disobedient, resistant. They are the problem in many ways for many communities. So I want to play with those particular differences: intractable problems or intractable youth. Bear with me, because I have to develop several points of this argument in order to make this case. Violence as an intractable social problem. Violence is a very difficult and intractable social problem. It's very difficult to control, manage, or solve. It's not impossible, which is where I don't want to go with the notion of intractable. But it's often defined in such a way that it cannot be solved. These are the people who throw their hands up and they say, we can't do anything about violence. We just have to live with it. Well, that's a particular view of the world that we're saying to people, that's the world that you have to learn to fit into. Violence as an intractable social problem is often seen as widespread, long-lasting, and intergenerational.
Now, this is also accurate. In the history of human beings, there is lots of violence in many different forms. But does that mean we don't try? That we see it as not worth doing something about? That we begin to define violence as being inherent to human nature, as opposed to a social problem that we are creating and that we are responsible for solving, because it is a social problem. It's not biological or inherited in any way. People who defy, oppose, or resist social norms are often seen as intractable people or problem people. When you start conflating these particular ideas, if we have a problem and there's violence all around us, who are the people who seem to be causing that problem? Who are the people where if they were not here, we wouldn't have this problem with violence? And Black youth are often identified as people who disproportionately contribute to violence within US society. What this does is it erases and minimizes other forms of violence than those that Black youth might engage in, but that might be systemic, invisible, hidden. It papers over histories of violence done to people of color, genocide of indigenous folk. It papers over public policy that is military policy that doesn't think about the fact that people die in wars. It papers over a lot of that. When you have a view that defines violence in such a way that it is coming from one source or identified with one problem population, that opens up the door to solving the problem of violence by targeting that population. So let me move to the second column of this particular slide, intractable people and violence. Who is more likely to be seen as disobedient, opposing, and resistant? Very often, young people, because they inherently do oppose things, or Black people, or people who are political protesters, who say, I don't like that rule, who don't follow the rules, who want to complain, but often in the spirit of trying to improve things. Disobedience, opposition, and resistance is not inherently a bad thing. I don't make a moral judgment on that. So this notion of people who are perceived as being intractable people and violent, who is more likely to be seen? Who is more likely to experience violence as a social problem? This is a fascinating thing because when you look at who the victims or survivors of violence are, they get much more, many of them do not get attention that they have actually been targeted by violence. This is certainly the case of women who experience a very high level of sexual violence and gender violence, but it's not seen as violence. It's seen as business as usual. It's seen as your lot in life as a woman. Now, when you begin to take these categories of race and gender and class, and you say, what do people do who experience violence? What are they likely to do? They can defy it, they can oppose it, they can be disobedient, they can resist it, but violence is designed to make people submit, to make people follow the rules. It's the power of last resort if you cannot convince people in the kind of situation that we have in the United States, which is one of social inequality. If you can't convince people to go to their assigned places, violence is often used to make that happen. But the people who are seen as intractable people, the problem people, what are the survival strategies that they engage in when faced with such problems? So Black youth, I argue here, are disproportionately affected by violence and are also disproportionately identified as the cause of violence. So where do we go with that? Here I'm going to introduce the whole notion of being in a lethal intersection. And this is where the term intersectionality, which many of you may have heard in many, many different places because it's shared everywhere. Intersectionality typically refers to systems of power where race, gender, class, sexuality, nation, a variety of systems of power or markers of power converge. But that's really general concept. It's a general framework. So what most people do is they understand intersectionality through the lens of personal experience. They can see how personal experience of with race and gender and class and sexuality converge in their own individual lives, which is why we're at a period of time of arguing that intersectionality is all about identity or personal identity categories. It's certainly that, but it's much more than that. So here, I'm looking at a population of Black youth who I'm going to argue are within a lethal intersection where they disproportionately experience violence and are blamed for violence within US society. What makes it a lethal intersection is that violence or the threat of violence occurs that aims to uphold social hierarchy. So you're more vulnerable to violence. And you're more vulnerable to it being lethal, meaning violence leaves evidence as premature or excess deaths are the outcome of violence. So it may not be an actual violent act that kills someone, like let's say something like rates of infant mortality that are much higher in the U.S. among Black babies. So that may not seem as violent. No one came in and actually, you know, killed the baby in front of you. But if you look at the patterns of premature and excess deaths, COVID gives us lots more data here, that I look at as systemic violence because it's lethal. If you're in certain categories of people, you are more likely to die or be exposed to violence. So this is the way I'm approaching the term lethal intersection as a guiding metaphor for talking about structural power relations. And then pulling back a little bit, talking about Black youth who are within a potential, within a lethal intersection structurally. They are Black, they are gendered, they are young, and many Black youth are poor or working class. You don't have to have all of those things, the intensity of all of those things, to experience violence, because violence is experienced differently by each person and by groups. But the convergence of those particular ideas at the intersection can produce violence and lethal violence. So that's what I'm looking at as kind of getting at this whole notion of Black youth, and we'll get to political activism at some point. I'm working my way down the food chain. So Black youth as a social problem. I've brought in some images of youth who, on the left, we have Trayvon Martin, who many of you may have heard about in 2012, who was killed by a neighbor who thought he was, I don't know what the neighbor thought, but the contemporary Black Lives Matter movement is often identified as starting with the death of Trayvon Martin. Now, the movement may have started with Trayvon Martin, but Martin is part of a long string of events like this. But he's a kid. Very often when you see that he was 17 when he died. And when you see the image of Trayvon Martin, he's presented in his hoodie. He's become an icon, almost of a certain kind of look. But I wanted a different picture to bring in to show you this is someone's child. This is a kid. The young man in the middle is Tamir Rice. He's 12 years old. He was 12 years old when he died. He was killed by the police in Columbus, I believe. No. Cleveland. He had a toy pistol. He was playing with a gun, with a toy pistol. You know, whatever games kids play with toy pistols. The police came, thought it was real, and killed him. That was it. Fascinating, because had he been a young white boy, or had he been a white girl playing with a pistol, I wonder if he'd been killed. Up in the right corner we have here, down to the four in the corner on the, what is this? My right, I guess, I don't know. The picture that doesn't have text attached to it. What you see is you see a police officer wrestling a young girl to the floor in her seventh grade classroom. Security, she did not die, but she did experience violence of being in a particular kind of lethal intersection. And what I wanted to bring in with these particular photos is the whole intersectional nature of it. It isn't just boys, it isn't just males or females, it's both, you see. So she's wrestled to the ground because she didn't obey orders. The whole notion of being disobedient and why, what was going on in that school that you had to have a school corrections officer? And the last young lady up, Makia Bryant, 2021, called the police herself. She was in foster care. She's 14 years old. And she called the police in Columbus, Ohio to come and help her. And they came, and because this particular child had mental health issues and they could not read the signs of what mental health issues meant, unfortunately, she also was killed by the police. So I'm pulling in examples, not just of adults who are who experience police violence or experience violence, state-sanctioned violence, but young people who are very much aware of their vulnerability to this type of violence and to these types of issues. They are not alone in the struggle, but they seem to get buried in how the issues are presented as a racial issue only. So the real question here that I'm also thinking about in this presentation, this is from W.E.B. Du Bois. To the real question, how does it feel to be a problem? I answer seldom a word. Now, he was talking about the fact that in 1901, people came up to him. This is in his classic book, The Souls of Black Folk. People came up to him, often well-meaning whites, that said, how does it feel to be a problem? How does it feel to be black? That's what they really meant. Black and problem being synonymous in some ways. And he said, I answer seldom a word. Well, that's not actually true. Du Bois lived to be 90-something years old, and he got a lot of words out about that. But in this particular essay, he's cluing us into the notion of how does it feel to be a problem? And I want to work with that, because I think the question of how does it feel to be a problem lies at the heart of Black youth activism, lies at the heart of what young Black people actually do, or young people in general actually do, but young Black people who bring to this question of violence and youth the whole notion of being perceived as a problem. So how does it feel to be a problem? Again, now I'm going to just repeat a little bit and just sort of build this out a bit more. Who is more likely to experience violence as a social problem? Black youth are disproportionately affected by violence within lethal intersections of race, class, gender, sexuality, and age. I'm going to argue that age is something that makes you vulnerable, being young, but it also, as I'll talk about in a minute, can be a source of strength and empowerment. Violence at home, neighborhoods, schools, and streets, everywhere. So it's not like you can escape violence by going to your private home. The neighborhoods that Black kids live in, the schools, the young woman I showed you wrestled to the floor, which have become increasingly like prisons in terms of how the schools are run for safety, and the streets themselves. Who is more likely to be seen as disobedient, opposing, and resistant? That young girl who was wrestled to the floor in her middle school classroom is much more likely to be seen as disobedient, opposing, and resistant. The literature on schooling consistently points out that Black kids are seen as being unruly, undisciplined, and needing a stronger hand. And this goes all the way down to preschool. They're more likely to be put out of school. So, who is more likely to be seen as disobedient, opposing, and resistant? Now, this becomes a really interesting issue if that same behavior is on the street and that the same behavior is perceived as being disobedient by a police officer who says, obey me, or let's say a kid with mental health issues doesn't know how to obey. All right, it's a mental health issue. It's not a dangerous issue. What are some survival strategies that, if you're perceived as the problem, what are some survival strategies that you engage in so to escape this violence? When faced with violence as a social problem, fitting in. People always try and fit in, but sometimes you can't fit in. They escape through addiction, depression, running away. They escape through anger turned inward and outward at the situation itself of being treated that way. So I want to open the door to the idea of defiance and disobedience as political strategies, because I would like to see youth who are, and I think that I can make the case this is what's happening, commitment to intractable political protest. Political protest that won't go away. It's stubborn. It's that whole second meaning of intractable, defiant, opposing, disobedient, resistant. It can be individual. We've all met that individual who just never backs down. But what about collective social commitment? What about generational commitment to how does it feel to be a problem and what do we do about it? So social problems, generational identity, and Black youth. I would argue that Black youth encounter common social problems that shape their collective experiences, memories, and a generational identity. It's individually experienced, but it is a collective, it's a collective experience at the same time. And I would identify some shared social problems that simply have not gone away and will have to be dealt with: poverty, education, violence. What is my place and purpose in the world? There's that question. I think we're seeing some significant turning points, specific events that occur to individual Black youth that in fact are catalysts for political activism by the group writ large. So this is where you're coming of age. Let's say you're coming of age as a young person. What is my place and purpose in the world? Can I see a future for myself? And over time, you're seeing a series of specific events that seem to be affecting your generation more intensely. So you say, can I see a future for myself? Now, hip hop, which I'll talk about in a few minutes a bit more, as a form of cultural politics, to me, is generational disobedience. It's where these debates occur among many young Black people through music, through pop culture, through hip hop. What comes out of this? Black youth and the Black Lives Matter movement. I'm going to argue, or I am arguing, that these conditions of from the bottom up trying to build an argument that is really trying to understand Black youth activism and led by Black youth is really looking at the issues that affect Black youth. So the Black Lives Matter movement is visible, but it may not continue on in this particular form, which is why I'm looking at the conditions that underlie it. Because if the conditions that underlie it and the people who take it forward do not do that, then we're thinking about movements in a very narrow way. But I wanted to put here, because I found this lovely graphic of this young woman in the middle. I call her a very, very young woman, who says, I am Tamir Rice. Now, that's a really interesting sign. Clearly, an adult assisted her with this sign, and she's at a demonstration. But the fact that somebody was upset about the killing of a child to that degree, to say, to take his or her daughter to I am Tamir Rice. We have another little one next to her. I am here for my future. Now, someone made that sign for her. But the point is, there she is. I don't know if she's Black, white, brown, whatever. She's got a cute little skirt on, and she's out there in the middle of a demonstration. The hoodie march, when Trayvon Martin became a symbol, and many people were wearing hoods. So the symbolism of this particular, of cultural politics, not just giving speeches, but basically speaking through the symbols of culture. We have at the bottom, Fight for Change, Black Lives Matter. I wanted to find images of young Black people who were at this movement, who show up at this movement. Over on the right, I brought in something a little different, and this is the Black Lives Matter at School project. And this is one that started off with a national week of action against the kind of violence in schools that Black kids were encountering. But it involves teachers, counselors, students, an alliance, and parents as well. And there is a book, Black Lives Matter at School, of how to take the ideas of the Black Lives Matter movement and implement them in educational settings. So I think we're at an interesting moment from where I sit of generational continuity, where Black youth as a social problem have encountered violence in such a way that politicizes Black youth who realize that could have been me. Black activism and generational continuity. I would say what we've got going here that's interesting and I think important in thinking about today's youth, I'm just basically going to give some like descriptive terms, the Black power generation and the hip hop generation. Very, very crude ways of cutting into this. But I'm just doing this for convenience because it's a presentation. The Black power generation, the 1950s to the 1980s, the hip hop generation, the 1980s to today, with a really important decade of overlap, the 1980s themselves, being the waning of the Black Power generation, and the 1980s being the ramping up of the hip hop generation. The slide I showed you with the music, it was from the 80s. You had to kind of see that getting to today with Kendrick Lamar. So the Black Power generation, the social problem was access to education. The catalysts were basically white resistance to school desegregation. The laws changed, but people didn't. So desegregating schools was a major issue and remains a major issue to this day in the United States, but without the violent resistance that occurred in the 50s, 60s, 70s, and beyond. That was a particular kind of racism that was exclusionary structural racism. The violence was state-sanctioned during the Jim Crow era, where you segregated people and you scared people to stay in their place. That's what the police were for. That's what the Ku Klux Klan was for. That was the history. We now are in a different period of time. The hip-hop generation has grown up with the promise that the future is open to them. You know, what is your place and purpose in the world? Anything you want to make of it would be the answer that we would tell them. But can that possibly be accurate when you're facing the social problem of violence in unsafe streets and schools, as schools become increasingly unsafe? That becomes an issue as well. The catalysts, the particular catalyst is police violence against youth. But the police are not the only issue here at all. But that's been the catalyst. The turning points come through those very visible attacks on youth and the failure of the social, of the justice system to do something about that. So in some ways, we're in a very different period of structural racism. It's not exclusionary that says, we don't want to see any Black people in any positions of power and authority ever. We've had President Obama here, but we still have quite an interesting situation of state-sanctioned violence, police who feel they can just go and shoot kids and get away with it and continue to do that. Case in the paper this morning, Senegalese immigrants in Syracuse. So this is the context for generational continuity. If the social problem went away, there would be no need to have the generational continuity of a political response to that particular problem. So summing up part one, a case of Black youth activism in the US. What are the social conditions that create shared experiences? I would argue for Black youth today, deindustrialization, public policies of mass incarceration, and the war on drugs. I haven't said much about that. I won't, but that's something you can look into. What are the catalysts that become turning points for generational consciousness? I'm going to argue incidents of police violence against young Black people, especially in an era of social media and cell phones. Technological change has made things possible that was not possible a generation ago. And what are the tools that are available to youth? Hip hop, cultural politics, having a big footprint in culture in terms of how we think about culture in general, because youth they can't vote until they're 18. The other tools are not available to them. So cultural politics takes on an outside presence in shaping the discourse of youth. And then the mass movement, these are kids who grew up and participated in a mass movement or mass social protest. And I think that really is important, the Black Lives Matter movement. Now, I don't know exactly how I would hook hip hop with Black political activism. That's something that I'm working on now, but I'm going to leave that. The next example of youth activism takes me to Brazil, where I've been traveling a fair amount. And in 2015, something pretty extraordinary happened. Many people in the U.S. do not seem to realize that Brazil, South Africa, and the United States are very large and important countries on their respective continents. That's how I would view this. I see the U.S. and Brazil and South Africa as sharing similar issues and concerns, but organized very differently in terms of history, culture, populations, et cetera. So I've been going to Brazil. This trip, I was supposed to get to South Africa. I'm not there with you. I'm still trying to get back, but I have managed to get to Brazil a fair amount. And this particular event fascinated me. In 2015, a very large number of youth in Brazil, high school students, walked out of schools. They said, our schools are not serving us. They are shrinking our budgets. They're taking away from the public schools. This was in São Paulo, the biggest city in Brazil, in Rio, and in other large cities of the country. This was not a coordinated mass movement where a leader stood up and said to students, why don't you have a mass movement? This was a grassroots movement on the part of kids. And I was fortunate enough to actually visit one of the free spaces that young people had created, where they set up alternative schools for themselves, where they could begin to talk about the kinds of issues that they thought were important. So I don't have a lot of time to really talk much more about this, but I've mentioned this to you and bring you some graphics to give you a sense of the events themselves, and also occupying a school meant they stayed there. This is one young woman who's sleeping on the floor, all right, who had to find a way to sort of manage themselves in the school, food, clothing, shelter, the whole thing for part of their movement. Now, from a social to a political generation, youth activism in Brazil, what are the social conditions that create shared experiences? Well, the list of contenders seem to show up from case to case to case from the point of view of youth. Poverty, violence, poor schools. What are the catalysts that become turning points for generational consciousness? Cuts to school budgets, but their experiences as students. A fair amount of student activism youth activism originates in school spaces because that's where kids are a lot if they're lucky enough to go to school. What are the tools, strategies available to youth? Social protests, the Occupy movement of schools in Brazil, social movements where education and violence become core issues in social movements as they are in Brazil, and cultural politics of hip hop as the voice of youth. I put on the side here a book, Letramentos de Reexistencia. This is a book where a colleague of mine has done a study on hip hop in Brazil to begin to tell us how did this come about? How did youth in Brazil, many of whom are Black youth, use pop culture for raising consciousness, for organizing movements, for doing a variety of things as a form of communication? We don't have enough studies on that, but I thought I would put that there. So developing broad, two final questions as I wrap up. The first has to do developing broader conceptions of activism. One thing that you may have seen in or heard in this talk is that I see activism as being much broader than voting and office holding or mass protest or social movement organization like Black Lives Matter or grassroots organizing, which is crucial, face-to-face on the local level, or art and activism, popular culture is important. Social media, I put down here Black Twitter until it became something else, was a site for conversations about all of the stuff that I brought forward. This is something that youth today can do in terms of organizing. But for youth organizing, they don't have access to a lot of these tools. Voting and office holding, they don't have access to. They have to try, because they're not voters. So they're often they're overlooked. Or mass protest is difficult to do if you're young and if you're in school or social. So when you start looking at if we only think about activism as one thing, mass protest, when you have a major protest in the streets and then when March for Our Lives goes away or we don't see Black Lives Matter protests, then there is no more activism. Not so. There's activism going on in these many of these other arenas. So I think it's important to develop a broader conception of activism, especially when conceiving or conceptualizing youth activism, rather than trying to fit youth into pre-existing categories of what counts as political activism. What we need to do is start with what they do and say and why, and build out activism from there. Second, who will be the next generation of political leaders? And this is really what I've been talking about throughout this entire talk. So this is my second main point, then I finish up. How is the current generation of youth building upon and reconfiguring the activism of past generations? Really important question. And I've given some clues all through the talk around issues of schooling and violence and music and culture and all of that. That's a conversation to have, you know, to really look at the current generation of youth. Second, how is the current generation of youth critical of contemporary political leadership? Youth don't like everything they see ahead of them as leadership. Now, you know, they're the first ones who said, Barack Obama has promised the world will be open to us, but his hands are tied in many ways because of he's telling us to just pull our pants up, try and fit in, back away from the hip hop, be respectable, and you too can benefit. And many youth said, that's simply not going to work. Let me tell you what things are like in my neighborhood. So I'm going to be critical of that particular discourse of the generation ahead of us that is profoundly assimilationist or says, you know, just behave, wait your turn. There may not be a turn for you if that's fundamentally the message. The next question, how is the current generation of youth critical for social justice movements? I think this is where the leadership is. They're critical for fresh leadership, for fresh ideas, for moving into the future and not just looking into the past and celebrating well-deserved but past strategies. What might coalitional politics look like among generations? This to me is sort of the Mamie Till, Emmett Till image of what are we looking at here in terms of coalitional politics and political struggles? And how is this process shaped within distinctive national contexts, specifically for me, the US, Brazil, and South Africa? And I'm going to leave you with some questions for this particular audience. From a social to a political generation, what path for youth activism in South Africa? I was not able to attend the meeting with you, so I cannot have the kind of conversation that I would love to have with each of you who are attending this particular conference. So I don't know the answers to these questions, but look forward to hearing your thoughts about them. What are the social conditions in South Africa that create shared experiences for youth? And I'm just going to pick up one that's a sociological one. This could be not relevant, but I'm sure there are others on the list. But to give you an idea of what I think about as being a shared social condition, the aftermath of HIV and COVID, that the loss of parents leaves young people to care for one another far more than perhaps had been the case in the past. That's important. What are the catalysts that become turning points for generational consciousness? I would want to know what's in the current political situation in South Africa that could serve as similar catalysts for the case that I'm in the middle of developing about Black youth in America and a little less so Black or youth in Brazil. What's in the current political situation around intractable social problems and intractable youth? What are possibilities for student activism? This is often where a lot of activism occurs, and my understanding that that is where a fair amount of activism occurred historically in South Africa, but that may not be the central place now, as it is not in the US because of the situation of schooling in the US. What are the tools, strategies available to youth? Legacies of an anti-apartheid struggle, that a tool? Grassroots organizing, my sense is there's plenty of that going on. We just never know about it because it's not covered. Cultural politics of hip hop, what else? So I don't know. I invite you to help me develop these arguments from your specific location and from the challenges of your specific projects. And I thank you very much for the opportunity to share my ideas with you today. Thank you.
Temba, is she with us? Good morning, Patricia.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Patricia Hill Collins, Professor Patricia Hill Collins joins us from Cincinnati, Ohio. It's about quarter to six, 6 a.m. where she is. So thank you so much for waking up bright and early to be with us. I'm going to invite some inputs from my colleagues, Dr. Candace Groenewald and Dr. Tolang Mokele. They're going to come and just make some brief inputs, a couple of provocations to get us going, but I do also want to allow people in the room to have space to respond. So maybe we can get three people with burning questions queuing this side. In the meantime, three people with burning questions queuing that side as Tolang and Candace make their way up.
Oh, the height issue. Morning, colleagues, and this is a very provoking presentation, an interesting presentation by Prof. And Prof has posed the question to us to say that what are the real social problems in what are the real social problems in our country? And I also want to put one question to Prof to say. Yes, I've seen the intersectional lenses that Prof indicated, but from a GIS perspective, I always think spatially. And then I would like to say that Prof and also the local scholars, we should also bring in the issue of locality into the aspects of a intersectional lens. My argument comes from the fact that in South Africa we have a big inequality when it comes to urban and rural differences. And then when you zoom into urban areas, we also have further inequality there because we have your informal settlements, we have our inequality. So the question is, how do we infuse those into intersectional lens in terms of addressing the challenges of our days and even the possible future? And then if I can bring into the present conditions into South Africa, Prof. Collins, we are currently sitting at 47% of unemployment when it comes to our youth, which is very scary. And then we don't know because it's growing, the unemployment rate. Inequality is growing, and as if I can indicate, a few years before COVID, as HSRC, we had a conference, similar conference, and the issues that were being addressed at that time, it was poverty, inequality, unemployment. The question that I would like to pose to us as scholars and scholars in the country is to say, what have we done to improve the steps that we're in at that time, because unfortunately, inequality is increasing. Unemployment is increasing. So what are we doing as scholars to assist government to address this issue? Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everyone. Good morning, Prof. I was told I get 2 minutes, and I don't like that because that was such a full presentation. I also had the privilege to read the paper before the time. Let me just bring this down a little bit so I don't have to stand on my toes. And I think that there were two things that stood out for me. I'm coming at this from a methodological perspective. And so from a methodological perspective, my work is really about how do we develop, define, embrace methodologies that encourage meaningful participation in the research that we do. And so I was thinking about this through those lenses. So two things. In support of the presentation, Alude, you mentioned this as well, the intersectional lens. It is such an important component for us to invest in the work that we do. It's not just a sexy term, but it is really a meaningful construct or a meaningful theory to apply. Why is this so? Because our lives are complicated, our lives are busy, our lives are complex, and we need to understand that all of those complexities influence how we understand an issue, how we understand people's lived realities, how we investigate those issues, and what we do with the outcomes of those. And so this particular lens is not just about being critical, but about being comprehensive in the way that we not just understand people's lives, but address the issues that we are contending with. So in that comprehensive nature, you were talking about adding different layers to this intersectional lens. And I think as emerging scholars, we have to do that. We have to really apply ourselves into how do we do this research that is comprehensive in different ways. So that was the first component that I thought really stood out for me in seeing people's lives as complicated, and that the reality is that people can be thriving and struggling at the same time. And what do we do in that instance, and how do we respond to the challenges in that space for different people from different spaces and from different contexts? The other piece for me was around activism, agency, and action. I think these are such important pieces, and often, I know when I was an emerging scholar, which I think I still am, but I often thought about what is my position as a researcher in activism, in advocacy. Is this the same thing? Is the interventions we do activism? Is that advocacy? Is that agency and change? And so we are currently in a methodological urgency to work with youth and with platforms that youth have access to and access, and in this way to work with them to capture, to represent, to represent, to present and illustrate their realities with them. We also need to think about how do we do this in a way that we don't, and I know our quants people will push back to this, but that we don't neglect the traditional ways that we do. This is about embracing the creative in the way that Prof spoke about the hip-hop space. We've had such amazing presentations around public ethnography, poetic inquiry, all of these different ways that tell of people's stories. But there can be a merge between the traditional and the creative in order to illustrate people's lives. And so I want to just check my notes. I want to also just kind of end with a few questions to add to our conversations. And so that is, and again, I'm applying a methodological lens here, but how do we meet youth where they are, and how do we find ways to tell these stories in creative and traditional and applied ways that we don't feel that we're compromising the science? A colleague always spoke about herself as a social scientist, and I've adopted that because that's who we are. We are social scientists trying to change the world. And so how do we do that in an applied but creative and still appreciating the traditional sense ways? How can we encourage meaningful participation in research that invests in youth, with youth, for youth, by youth? And then lastly, how can we make our research or find avenues for advocacy and activism that promotes active youth citizenship and decision-making in our country, given the various social inequalities and social ills that we've been speaking about? So those are my thoughts for now. Thanks so much, and yeah, I'm happy to hear your thoughts.
Thank you so much, Candace and Tolang. So, Prof. Collins, two interventions there from our senior researchers, and we'll open up the floor momentarily. The first really around locality and the importance of that, and the second around meeting young people where they are as researchers, coming together to really create impactful work.
These are both, first of all, Ken, this is working, you can hear me?
Perfectly.
This is the first
perfectly.
I've heard my voice this morning. So what I would say about, let me just take, to me, the two questions go together in an interesting way. I'm sort of getting a double view of myself. Thank you. That's much better. I can sort of see myself once. I was getting a little strange thing going on there. To me, they go together. I think the core question is for youth. Let me just talk about youth. Without hope, it's very difficult to do anything. So my question, what kind of future do you see for yourself, means that they must participate in building that future. So this whole question of making it meaningful for them and taking that perspective into account really speaks to where youth are. This whole notion of locality is really crucial. I am trying to get much more locality into the framework of intersectionality, mainly by focusing on the notion of nation as a political unit, to make us aware of the political boundaries around where youth are, and also the specific places of nations. But in no way does that mean that that system of power is the only one. So narrowing that lens down to locality, to rural, to urban, to getting that kind of specificity, rather than overgeneralizing about youth and saying youth are all cut from the same cloth, not so. So developing work that frames out the patterns of inequality and the experiences that youth have on a micro level is really important. And that's the science of it all, to be perfectly honest. I mean, knowing the situation of youth, the quantitative work is crucial, the demographic work is crucial in giving us the science that's so we can stand on legitimate research in making our knowledge claims. But it cannot stop there. And I think that's really the concern. So the methodological question is really very interesting and important because it asks, how do we merge some of the tools of ethnography or the tools of qualitative research, those that have been traditional and those that we are creating, by involving youth in the research itself? Now, I'm going to wander around just a minute here so I can get my bearings. You've been focused for a little while, and I'm trying to get up to speed here. But I think I just wanted to say a word about perhaps my own work and how I view it. I view my own work as intellectual activism. I don't necessarily assume that activism is always advocacy that you can see. But in some ways, the selection of topics, what I choose to work on, how I choose to work at it, these are lifelong questions of what lies at the heart of my work. It's intellectual work in service of broader social goals, or intellectual work in service of social justice, or intellectual work that makes a contribution to the much larger questions of social inequality or poverty or whatever it is that we're looking at. So that frame has been really helpful for me in avoiding the kinds of questions of, is my work activism? Is it scholarly? Is it, you know, I sort of back away from all that and assume I know why I'm doing it. If you lose your way and you forgot why you started doing this work in the first place, it is very easy to get sort of end up in detours that don't necessarily match you and your questions and what you want to work on. So I love this notion of asking that core question the way you came at it. I also think intersectionality provides a very powerful tool for both of the comments that were brought up by the first two speakers, because it allows us to look both at, it allows us to have tools for making alliances among people whose experiences are very different. If you can see that maybe I'm rural, I'm living in a rural area, you're living in an urban area, I'm a girl, you're a boy, you know, whatever, however we slice and dice it, but that the broader things that bring us together are working on common social problems that we have that take specific forms for each of us, then that is a way of pulling things together and moving things forward. But I would circle back to the initial comment, which is hope. The issue is to involve youth in building the future, because it is their future they are building, and to make it clear that we are placing the tools of science, the tools of our leadership, we do know more because we are in fact adults and have been around and know more about certain things, but they know more about what they're willing to do or not willing to do. And so often where things go wrong is just to go and extract information from youth and say, we're just going to come back and tell you what we think we're going to do about your situation and help you that way, as opposed to making youth active participants. There is no shame. Let me back up a little bit here. When you are desperate, that's one kind of situation in terms of that kind of poverty, you know, starvation, those types of issues. But if we're talking about a hopelessness, people are willing to live under conditions that are not optimum. But they can be incredibly resourceful and use creativity to think about solutions to problems that we have not even considered because we don't experience the problems in the ways that they do. So I really believe that youth are really good at diagnosing certain problems by just crying out about them. but that we need a team of people, both among youth, among researchers and youth, among supportive social scientists and researchers of all levels. So to know the boundaries of what you're saying, the contributions that you're making, but recognizing that you're part of a team and other people are also part of that team, even though they're not typically recognized as such within many models that we've inherited in social science. I probably could have said that a bit faster, but I'm still waking up. So hopefully in there you can see the essence of what I'm going for. Let's move on.
Thank you, Candace and Tolong. You can step down. Now we welcome questions from the floor. We are opening up questions to colleagues who'd like to ask one. Please don't be shy. Approach the microphone. Patricia didn't get up at the crack of dawn for nothing. So please make your way if you have an input. Patricia, I think many of us in the room are going to be adopting this identity as intellectual activists. I know I certainly am. It's a really helpful...
You like that?
Yeah, love that. Colleagues, questions? Go ahead. Grab a mic. I also want to say that presentation really was a masterclass in building an argument. And also, appreciating the historicization aspect, which I think often we forget. We think these social problems emerge from the ether, but there's a lot to be learned from that intergenerational dialogue. Go ahead, please say your name and where you're from.
Okay. Thank you very much for the opportunity. My name is Colin Mongale, and I'm from the Northwest University. My question to you, Professor Collins, is looking at historical incidences. For instance, when you go to the Middle East and North Africa between 2010 and 2011, we actually experienced what was famously known as the Arab Spring, which one of the contributing factors was issues of inequality and marginalization of the youth. Hence, they took to the street to go and topple down their governments. And when you look into South African context, in July 2021, we experienced widespread violence in KwaZulu-Natal and Gauteng cities. Although they came under the pretext of the arrest of former President Jacob Zuma, the actual reality behind those protests were as a result of inequality and unemployment amongst the youth. And amongst your presentation has been issues surrounding inequality and deprivation, especially of the black community. So my question to you is, considering these previous instances, what is your projection, especially in as far as mass protests are concerned, especially the ones that will lead to rebellion of the poor and the one that will seek to topple down government of the United States unconstitutionally, provided that it has been an authoritarian democracy? Thank you very much.
Thank you, Colin. Let's have one more input before Prof. Collins responds. Two hands that side. Adam, you can go ahead and also make your way to the mic. Anybody, any takers this side of the room?
All right, no, thank you so much, Professor Collins. So from my side, as I think in your presentation, you spoke about the intergenerational gaps within this idea of activism around even protests. So my question is, being located in South Africa, we have many generations that have gone through the conceptualizations of protests, what they mean, what are they for, who are they fighting? And we find ourselves in a conundrum where the older generation has this perception of how to perform activism, while the youth has a different perception. And for example, using the example of the economic freedom fighters in South Africa and how they are radical in how they fight racism in South Africa, the older generation usually says, this is not how you fight. What we prefer is dialogue. And over time, we have seen that the dialogues that they said they are willing to have not worked over time, because this is, in the contemporary context, we find ourselves still presented with the very same issues that they were presented with. And it shows that then the dialogues that they had, how they conceptualized how to rectify the context in which they found themselves in, didn't work. So my question is, how do we bridge this intergenerational gap in how we conceptualize activism as these two generations. And because for the youth, it's not working. We don't want to have a dialogue. The dialogues are not working. Hence, we still have this systemic racism, which is confronting the youth, and it's crippling the youth of today. We don't see a future because the dialogues have not been working. And the youth is saying that we have been far too nice. The older generation has been far too nice. They are not radical enough to confront the system of racism in our communities, economic inequalities. It means that you are not radical enough. But when the youth is now fighting, how they are fighting is problematic for this older generation. So I just want you to please enlighten us on how, what is the best strategy to confront this intergenerational gap in fighting these social and economic inequalities, and in which the context we find ourselves in, especially in the context of South Africa. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for those two inputs. Go ahead, Prof.
Let me pull both of those together and think, and just talk a little bit about the American situation, because I think framing things in terms of what's the best strategy is can be, we have to identify what are conflicts among strategies, but what is the best strategy may not be the best thing to do. I look at the Black Power movement, the civil rights Black Power era in the US, which was a variety of strategies, where some people were looking to for advocacy with the government. They were having dialogues with agents in the government. They were trying to capture positions of power and authority in the government. And some were far more radical. They were not particularly interested in that. They were interested in building independent institutions. So there was quite a bit of conflict politically during that period of time. But what happened was they balanced one another out. They were able to not get in each other's way and fight with one another. They, in fact, saw this as two really different strategies, political strategies for bringing about change, one of which may have mass movements, one may have social protest, may have that kind of face to it, whereas the other was silent and behind the scenes. It was like a stealth action of capturing the jobs and hiring people and making sure that that happened. Now, I think that was pretty effective during that period of time. But what has come out of that is the generational conflict that you point out, I think, has been the case in the United States. It's represented quite differently. Earlier on, I commented on the Obama administration, which in some ways had to happen. Achieving the pinnacle of power in the U.S. by having a Black president had to happen in order to see what was left to be done because of the backlash that the Obama administration faced. From day one, people said, we will do everything we can so he will fail. It really enabled everyone to see an alternative set of enemies. Now, youth in the middle of this, who had been promised the future by this particular strategy, you're talking about dialogue, kind of that kind of thing, recognize that was not going to happen. So in some ways, we have two intractable populations here. We have a generation that says, we believe in this because what we were able to do made things happen. We got freedom, we got a president, we got jobs. And you said, some of you did, but the rest of you did not. What about all of us? And this is why I was bringing in the whole case of hip-hop, because I think that's where you find that particular voice. Now, what has happened in the U.S. has been the recognition on the part of senior leaders in civil rights that they are not the leaders in the same way. It's the notion of, let me just see how I can describe this. There's a person who came from through a major figure, a Black feminist figure in the civil rights movement, Ella Baker. And she had a philosophy of working with youth. And she said very clearly, youth are the future. What I'm doing is for youth. I'm not trying to tell them what to do. She had an actual saying that was, strong people do not need strong leaders. And that is what she would tell youth. You do not need someone to tell you what to do. You don't need a strong leader that you're always fighting with. That person isn't actually your most effective leader. Strong people do not need strong leaders because they have the ability to think for themselves and to identify solutions or ways forward that may not be apparent to the people who are the leaders. So that's what lies at the heart of, to me, the intergenerational communication or coalitions.
is recognizing that and getting out of the way in some ways and being a resource for youth. Now, that is very difficult for some senior people to, whether they are academics or whether they are politicians or whether they're just somebody in your family that says, I'm old and you should listen to me, to understand in terms of the changing social context that we're in. The context of 50 years ago is not the context of now, whether it's South Africa, Brazil, or the United States. So the question of what are the appropriate strategies now have to be diagnosed by looking at cases that are successful and that have not been successful, or maybe we're not sure. The first question about mass movements, Arab Spring, young people rising up. What I see with Arab Spring is not necessarily that you have a social protest and all of a sudden there's a revolution and then there's social change and inequality and all that is fixed. It's rather a statement of the depth of care and concern among a large group of people who may be visible on one day and not visible on another day. The situation in Iran is similar in some ways, because that's a very repressive situation for women, and yet women threw off their headscarves a year ago, not because they just got up one day and decided to do it, because it was a catalyst that was able to spur that movement. But without having an organizational setup ready or a politics ready for that mass movement, it can be very difficult to move forward. So I'm a believer in the local, and this gets me back to the regional and the local, working on the local. And the basics that really get people connected into a movement are feeding them, housing them, and saying, we're gonna do what we can for you. This was a model that was actually used by the Black Panther Party that basically said, we can feed children, and the government has told you that they can't feed your children, but we can feed your children through a breakfast program. And that stuck with people. The fact that there was that level of commitment to each other on a local level and local communities. So there's a lot to work with here, but the bigger issue for me is the problems are not going to go away. The youth, the next generation will be the leaders of tomorrow, and what kind of leaders do we want to cultivate and to support? The way you grow to be a strong leader is to practice, not just practice obedience, practice taking the lead. Practice problem solving. And the best time to do that is when you're young, because you can think bigger than seeing all of the limitations that come later on, that will come later on. So I think these two questions do go together. And a dialogue, by the way, is a wonderful thing, but sometimes it is time to dialogue, and other times it is not an effective strategy. It's a stalling strategy. Let's just keep talking about this. So it's a strategy like others. Sometimes there's time for that, and other times no. So anyhow, that's how I would begin to cut into these very big questions that you raise. Stop here.
And I think that's an excellent place to leave it. Professor Patricia Hill Collins, colleagues. Thank you so much for joining us, Patricia. We'll let you crawl back into bed as we move on with our program and connect with you offline.
Could I just say one more thing?
Absolutely.
Before we close, you know, the little bit that I see of you from this angle, you are such a wonderful looking audience, and what you do is so important. I would like to give you a word of encouragement, particularly those of you who are junior scholars and you're still finding your way in some way, because what can happen if you're not careful is you forget why you're doing what you do. And if you keep that at the center and think about the ways of being creative to work on behalf of the people who have need. Even if sometimes they tell you they don't understand what you're doing, or why are you spending all your time doing that when you could be doing something else? Why weren't you at the protest? Whatever it is, as long as you are convinced in the strength of the power of ideas and the power of research, and the power of research for your situation in your country, which is really important. I've been following South Africa from a distance for some time. I've had the chance to visit 3 times, once after, directly after freedom, after having followed that struggle as a college student. and saying, wow, what's going on there? And seeing the challenges that your nation faces now, I, for one, am honored to be able to say a few words of encouragement to the budding scholarly research generation that can think outside the traditional boxes of what research is. So it's lovely for me to see you and to encourage you. And my only regret is that I could not be with you, so I got up to say that. Thank you.
All right, colleagues, there's a lot to take in there. So as we shift gears to our next item, we've had 3 days of thought-provoking, considered, a vast array of presentations, diverse, some robust discussions, points of contention and discussion. And so we have one more item to get out of the way, following over from last night's awards. You've all been voting. You've been casting your votes. You've been marking that X in preparation for next year. And we have four winners to announce for the award. And I'm going to invite Director of Legal Services and Compliance, Mbulungeni Nepfumbata, to come up, as well as acting head of AISA, Dr. Palesa Serejane, to come up as well.
Mbulu, is she coming? So we did promise, good morning, good afternoon, colleagues. We did promise 3 awards, but sadly, we have to give 4 awards. So it's not sadly. And so the first award, should I read the title of the paper first and the person can guess who they are? Examining Factors Associated with Unemployment in South Africa, a Focus on Unemployment Among Black Africans, Kenneth Shabalala from Northwest University. A photograph, and then and I'm sorry we don't have a live band to serenade you, but in our heart we're singing. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, the next paper, the best presenter. Why don't you go into the suburbs? Why are you targeting us? Trust and mistrust in HIV vaccine trials in South Africa. Siyabonga Tabeti from the HSRC. I'm sure Siyabonga is from KwaZulu-Natal. This is the colleague who starts every question with thank you for a beautiful presentation. So we're thanking him for a beautiful presentation. Data mining and sentiment analysis of cholera outbreak in Hammanskraal, a case study. Dr. Emmanuel Fundisi from the HSRC. And our final award, a tailored mHealth intervention for improving antenatal care seeking and health behavioral determinants during pregnancy amongst adolescents and young women in South Africa, a development and study protocol, Renal Supal from the HSRC. Thank you very much. And just to our four presenters, you need to see Sandy at the end of the session for you know what. So colleagues, my name is Sharlene Swartz. It's been my pleasure to pilot this plane for the last few months, actually. It's been a real delight to see the participation that you've brought, your best game that you've brought to this conference, but also over the last few months to look at the almost 200 abstracts that we received. We did turn down many abstracts, actually. We made sure that all the HSRC emerging researchers were here, but we actually turned down many more than we accepted to come to this conference. And so it tells us that there's an appetite for people to present their work, to come to conferences and to network, and to rub shoulders with people who they've read, people who they may be working with in the future, writing a paper with, collaborating with, and that's been really exciting. So in total, 142 papers over the past few days, posters. I attended 23 papers. I listened to 23 papers. And so if I try to summarize this conference, I don't want to only summarize the 23 that I heard. I want to say that the predominant papers that have been happening in this last few days have been about the divides in our country, in our continent, on the world. The divide between local and the global in climate change issues. And mainly, this room has focused on the small incremental acts that can happen locally. The educational divides in our country, on our continent, about quality, about access, about early childhood development, and about parents' involvement in education. The digital divide, and the divide that is cross-cutting. The divide that is cross-cutting. The divide between temporary employment and long-term employment for young people. I've heard about 6 or 7 papers on that topic. The divisions between people in our country and our continent. Migration, xenophobia, and violence. The divisions between rights, cultural rights, and women's rights. There's been a huge theme going through this conference. The age divide when it comes to agriculture and farming. And one of the most amazing statistics I've heard from 3 papers is that most farmers in our country are over 60, and no young people are coming up behind them. The divide between research and policy, it's been huge, and people have addressed that. So what have we tried to achieve in this conference? I am a sociologist. And one of the papers that I read a few years back was by Eric Olin Wright, where he says, we've got a few ways of changing the world. One, revolution, and Professor Patricia Hill Collins has spoken about rupture and protest and revolution. But then we've also got the small ways in which we work at community level to erode the things that cause harm and suffering in people's lives. And so often we stop our interventions at community level. And colleagues, the thing that is really important, and I think it speaks to some of the divides that this conference has addressed, is we've got to get our work into the hands of people in power. We've got to, in the words of Eric Olin Wright, tame this world in which we live in through policy, legislation, and then making sure that that policy is implemented over time. I'm not going to do a whole talk on Eric Olin Wright's work, but it's a really important piece for me because it says that activism happens at so many levels. So what have we tried to do in these last few days? We've tried to provoke you, encourage you, and give you a platform to bring your best game. And we did it by not just saying, come and present your paper. We said, please, would you bring a mentor with you, both from within the HSRC and from your university, and work with them to make your papers the best they can possibly be. And we've asked senior academics from the HSRC to be in the room and be listening to your papers. Because you know what normally happens? You have a conference for emerging researchers, and all the emerging researchers go to listen to the emerging researchers speak. And the senior researchers go and sit in the bar and chat. And this time that didn't happen. I hope that you were all really encouraged to see senior researchers in the room. I know it also terrified you. right? But I also know that they asked you questions that I think will help you, will develop you. But also, you are going to be working with them in the not-too-distant future. I like to say this, that I want to treat you very well, because in a few years, you are going to be the senior academics, and I'm going to be about to plant potatoes and looking for some work, right? And I'm going to come to you because you'll be the deans and the vice chancellors in our country. So we want to treat you well. But here's the question, how did we do? And the answer is, some of us did incredibly well in some areas, and some of us did incredibly well in other areas, but not all of us did very well in every area. And let me tell you why I'm going to be frank with you. Some of you, I watched, couldn't read your own slides because the writing was so small, right? And colleagues, you've got to be able to communicate your work. And those are the things that I hope that you got feedback from your colleagues, from your peers, from the senior academics in the room about. Some of you spoke so fast, you couldn't hear yourself speak, right? Because you were so anxious, so nervous. And you've got to do better to communicate these ideas, because whether you are going to be an activist that tries to smash and rupture the system, or tame the system, or erode the system, you've got to be able to communicate your work. Some of you hit the ball out of the park, and we've recognized you last night and this morning. Your work was relevant, it was important, it went beyond description. And it said, here's the things that we think must change. Some of you made too big a leap from what you did to what you're recommending, and you might have to step back a little bit. So why am I being so frank? Again, some of the senior academics could have done a better job at mentoring you. Some of you could have asked for more help. Why am I being so frank? A small story. I have been to 4 universities in my life. You've seen my bio. We've all been to great universities in the country, around the world. One of those universities ignored me. One of those universities treated me as if everything I said was amazing. One of those universities treated me as if everything I said was terrible. And another university challenged me, helped me, encouraged me, and made me grow from being an emerging scholar to becoming a more senior scholar. Those 4 universities, can I tell you who they were? And then you can guess which one was the one that was most encouraging to me. WITS, Harvard, Cambridge, University of Zululand. Which one was the most encouraging to me? Which one did I learn the most from? The University of Zululand. And I tell that story because it's not obvious, right? Maybe you thought it was WITS or Cambridge. But actually, it's not the university. It was the people who saw me and said, come, Charlene, don't do that, do this. Come, Charlene, practice, prepare, do better. Don't just wing it, right? Be the best you can if you really want to change the world. So I've entitled my summary, Words for the Road Ahead. And I've just got 4 quotes and a song because, you know, DJ Shazza in the house. My team at the HSRC, I always say this, you've got to learn to speak your mind even if your voice shakes. Breathe, prepare, visualize, and then speak. Audre Lorde says this, when we speak, we are afraid our words will not be heard or welcomed. But when we are silent, we are still afraid, so it's better to speak. Desmond Tutu, don't raise your voice, improve your argument. And finally, Maya Angelou, up from a past that's rooted in pain, I rise. Leaving behind nights of terror and fear, I rise. Into a daybreak that's wondrously clear, I rise. Bringing the gifts that my ancestors give, I rise. A song.
I've been staring at the coastline, thinking of every choice I've made to leave me here right now. Standing on solid ground, and I've been hiding in the shadows, wondering if I'm on the right road, someplace I'm
colleagues, that's my wish for you. I want to see you rise. Every colleague here wants to see you rise, and I'm honored to have been able to give you a small platform to do that this past week. So thank you, everybody. Either Sarah or Leickness are going to come and help me thank everybody.
Thank you so much, Sharlene, and good afternoon to everybody. At least I didn't fall when I was coming up the stairs. Thank you so much. I think this has been one of the best conferences we have held in a long time. Thanks a lot to all of you for being here. I hope that we've all learned something that we will treasure. Before the CEO closes the conference, I thought that I should take this moment to acknowledge a lot of people who worked behind the scenes and made this conference possible. To start with, of course, I wish to thank members of our board, Dr. Cassius Luisi, who you saw yesterday, over the past 2 days, Professor Ibo Mandaza, Dr. Komoto Kasonkola, and Ms. Shamim Manju. Thank you for coming and spending these past few days with us. I also wish to thank the keynote speakers for all the sessions, starting with Ms. Chido Mpemba, and then Professor Thabo Msibi, Professor Musa Saurobe, and this morning, Professor Patricia Hill Collins. We also wish to acknowledge the two emerging scholars who presented in the opening plenary, namely Krish and Nantuebo. Of course, putting together something like this requires an organizing committee. Thank you to our CEO for the leadership you provided in this. Sharlene, you were in the driver's seat. Thank you for steering the team, which consisted of Bongi, Alude, Pumi, Alistair, Jackie, and Lucky. Would like to thank our external partners who chaired some of the sessions. These are Dr. Anyen Kweti Nyano from UCT and Dr. Leonard Awejene from StatsSA. Of course, behind the scenes, we also had the team led by our able Bongi. Thank you, with your team that helped with the logistics. Ivy, Sandy, Akona, Tessa, Hilda, Mandy, Antonio, Issa, Temba, Goodluck, Tabang, Tabo, Sipamandla, Augustinus, Maxwell, Balekle, and Marilyn. Of course, we wouldn't be here if we didn't have some money. Thank you to the HSRC finance and supply chain management teams for diligently assisting us with the logistics. Of course, we heard about our scientific committee. Thanks to Tolan, Ilham, Yasser, Zainab, Musa, this Musa Mabaso from HSRC, Chloe, Stephen, Chuck, and Jolene. Thanks to the chairs of the parallel sessions. I think there are just too many to mention now. Of course, thanks to all the presenters in all these sessions. Of course, we have had this lovely setting. We wish to thank the hotel staff, the audiovisual people, and sound engineers as well. Congratulations to all the 11 winners, or 10 winners rather, from last night. Sorry, I added one. We added one this morning, or today. Thanks to the 4 best presenters as well. Lastly, on that point, I wish you well. Thank you so much. Okay.
Everything was said. Let me echo all sentiments and thank Leickness for your leadership. Thank you so much. This morning's session, I think, went fantastically well, and I think it will be amiss for me not to thank Alude for your own leadership this morning. And I thought that the questions were also as spot on. Congratulations to Kenneth, to Siabonga, Ronel, and Emmanuel. I think I've said a mouthful in the last 2.5 days. Let me spend some time in acknowledging the senior researchers present in this room from HSRC who have done an exceptional job, firstly by just being here. Just by being here, knowing the pressures that are back home, back in the offices, where you could have, colleagues. I wish I could call you by name. You could have been in the office today, writing those journal publications and the books, and writing and finalizing your SEPSAM reports, and checking individuals in the field from the CESAS data and making sure that they're doing their work. You were here. The transformation, and sometimes what we talk about as capacity building, does not just make itself. And there are many of us who pontificate, who politicize capacity building and transformation from the ivory towers of our offices as we write another journal article and another journal article. But there are those of us who are sitting in this room who are dedicated to making sure that capacity building and that next generation, we do see it eventually. And I want to thank my colleagues who are here, who've made that sacrifice. I see you, Michael, I see you, Ben, I see you, Jare, and I see many of you, I see you, Mbumi. I do appreciate, and I want to echo the sentiments from last night. Indeed, you can walk very fast, but that will be alone. But if we walk together, we can walk very far. And I think that is what we have just demonstrated as a true HSRC spirit. I see Thierry is here. I see many of you are here. And I want you to know that as much as I always say, I see you emerging researchers, I see your tenacity, but I also want to say that I see my colleagues from HSRC standing up and doing the difficult work of transformation, not only for HSRC, but for this country. You've also opened up your hearts to the 60 non-HSRC. So you've also gone beyond the call of duty. You've not only said it is also my salary, it's also important that I do what I do because the employment contract says that I have to be HSRC, but you've also said I'm also going to be a steadfast South African, African who believes in this country and the future of this country. And I think that it would be amiss for me not to acknowledge you. And I see Peter is still here with all the pressing writing that he still needs to do. Let me also just maybe say two last things. I met yesterday with emerging researchers. Very full in that room. I was nervous, very nervous. And my own boss, my own chairperson, left the room. And I made a joke at Dr. Libisi. I said, that's how politely you tell your boss to exit the room so that you can have other conversations. I was not chasing you away, Dr. Libisi, not at all. There are three things that came out of that conversation. Well, four things that came out of that conversation that we need to take forward together. We agreed that much as an organization, as myself, there are certain things that we need to do. You also have your own responsibility. The first one is that we are going to have quarterly come together lunchtime, and we're going to continue some of the discussions that we've had yesterday. Your responsibility is to show up for those meetings and engage. Again, it's engagement. It's not problems, problems, problems. It is problems with solutions, and let's walk that journey together. And again, echoing that the sentiments from the first day or even yesterday, it is not what ask us, not what HSRC can do for you, but what you can do for HSRC and indeed this country. And our senior academics at HSRC have demonstrated that they can also do that, their part, and it is important as emerging researchers that you do your part. So that's the first thing. The second thing that we've discussed is around your own funding for your PhDs and your masters, and your masters. And I'm happy to announce that as early as this morning, I had to wake up very early and meet with our director of HR to resolve that policy issue that you challenged me on, and come up with what we are thinking now as a potential study grant for those of you who are struggling with your fees from the various universities. Again, I want to thank our director, HR, firstly for waking up very early in the morning. She reminds me sometimes that the pace and the demands are sometimes very, very, very big coming from the office. But she's here, and she woke up very early to meet with me to address some of these pressing issues. The third issue relates I think the two urgent matters around contracting. Again, we've had a discussion, and there's a way forward, and we will feedback directly as soon as possible. But I thought that I should, in the spirit of Congress, would in the spirit of Congress come back and report what we need to do, so that you hold me accountable, you hold us accountable in relation to these things. So the contract issue will be resolved. The last issue, which is very close to my heart, and as I addressed you yesterday on the three agendas that I want to drive very strongly with the utmost support from the board, we spoke about the Africa agenda. That's the first agenda. The second agenda was the transformation agenda. The third agenda was the knowledge agenda. And the last issue spoke directly to this matter around your challenges around writing and publishing and what needs to be done. And I was happy to report. Mokhanzo and the directors are present here. We have a meeting very soon, and our emerging researchers are challenging us to go back to the draft publication strategy that you have drafted, that we need to discuss at our next meeting, so that some of the ideas that are coming from emerging researchers, we can fuse them into this, so that they are also their ideas around writing and publishing. Make no mistake, our emerging researchers want to write, want to publish. They need particular support, but they also have ideas. So those are the four things from the emerging researchers that I thought I should relay back to this meeting in the spirit of transparency, but also in absolute spirit of accountability. With that, let me again thank all of you for being here, for participating, for being who you are. I see you, I appreciate you, and I want to also spend some time, at least for as long as I'm at the HSRC, listen and experience some of what you are experiencing, so that we build a better HSRC, a flourishing HSRC, but certainly a flourishing South Africa, our country and our continent. Again, I want to thank the board of HSRC for the leadership and steadfast support. Thank you. I take instructions. Sharlene has given me strict instructions, and I can see Bongi as well nudging to say that the conference is closed. Please travel safely.